Samuel, talking about a young boy. The boy Samuel was serving God under Eli's direction. Now, be clear, Eli was the priest, the high priest of Israel. This is before they had kings, before they had like a real structured monarchy or hierarchy of political leadership. At that season of the Israel's formation as a nation and a people following Yahweh or Adonai, Jehovah, just God, we call, of course, God. That time, they just relied on the priest to help guide the people of Israel. And so at an early age, Hannah kept her word and gave Samuel to the priest and the temple. And from there on, Samuel was living in the temple with Eli, all right? Getting ready for his life mission. And I don't know about you, but that's quite a mission, amen, to just have your whole life in the service of God. Woo, some heaviness, right? All right, here we go. We're going to go back to reading because I get caught up. What's the word? Editorializing, I've been told. The boy Samuel was serving God under Eli's direction. This was at a time, listen, when the revelation of God was rarely heard or seen. And one night, Eli was sound asleep. His eyesight was very bad. He could hardly see. And it was well before dawn. The sanctuary lamp was still burning. Samuel was still in bed in the temple of God where the chest of God rested, the Ark of the Covenant. And then God called out, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel answered, "Yes, I'm here." Then he ran to Eli saying, "I heard you call. Here I am." Eli said, "I didn't call you. Go back to bed." And so Samuel did. God called again, "Samuel, Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli. "I heard you call. Here I am." And again, Eli said, "Son, I didn't call you. Go back to bed." And this all happened before Samuel knew God for himself. It was before the revelation of God had been given to him personally. God called again, "Samuel," the third time. Yet again, Samuel got up and went to Eli. "Yes, I heard you call me. Here I am." That's when it dawned on Eli that God was calling the boy. So Eli directed Samuel, "Go back and lie down. If the voice calls again, say, 'Speak, God. I'm your servant, ready to listen.'" Samuel returned to his bed. Then God came and stood before him exactly as before, calling out, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel answered, "Speak, I'm your servant, ready to listen." It's the word of God. For us, the people of God, let us say thanks be to God. So we're going to talk today, divine interruptions. That's what we're going to talk about for a few moments, divine interruptions. Bow your heads with me. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to say thank you that you call out to us. Thank you that you speak to us. Thank you that you want to be in communication with us. Bless the word of God that has been read for us. The people of God, I pray that you will hide this word in our hearts so we will not sin against you. And please send your anointing that makes preaching and teaching easy. And we'll say thank you in Jesus' name we pray. Let the people of God say amen. Somebody say divine interruptions. Divine. Now, hearing the voice of God is indeed one of the greatest learned skill sets that the child of God must cultivate. And we must be clear, certainly, that it is the case for many of us that we don't hear God that well. We hear a lot of things well. Amen. When I ride down the street, I love to have my music up loud so everybody can hear what I hear. Amen. But I was reading this fascinating article about how humans are born with 30,000 sound-sensing hair cells in our ears that help us to hear. And over the course of our life, due to loud noises, not music, due to medications, due to natural aging, these sound-sensing hair cells die off, and they don't grow back. So in many respects, we only get one chance as human beings to protect our hearing, our capacity to hear. Now, what's so fascinating about this article is that it is talking about how most recently folks at MIT, you know, that Massachusetts Institute of Technology, where all the brains go, amen. Folks that with big heads and big brains, don't do that? Well, yeah, all right. Real smart people. MIT, they are there and they are demonstrating technology, or at least some treatments in mice. Started out with the mice. I don't know why I would start with mice. But they're starting out with mice that are showing that we could increase or regenerate our hair cells so they can indeed begin to grow back or function more better as we get older. And I found this to be so fascinating because if indeed it is the case that our hearing can really only be protected, by making sure we don't have these loud noises. Another cause of the loss of hearing, they say gradually throughout life, is toxicity of chemicals or some kind of injury. All causes the hearing cells to be destroyed. That it helps me, particularly as we're talking about keys to hearing the voice of God, be able to pull some parallels, I believe, as to what is at stake when you and I don't protect our spiritual ears. Because how many of you know that there are many, many factors that work to try and damage our ability to hear God? There's a lot of toxicity out here today. There's a lot of injury, trauma that you and I will go through. There's a lot of external factors that would keep our capacity to hear from growing and regenerating, if you will, being renewed. And this is one of the reasons why I believe God seeks to interrupt us so frequently. Because God is trying to help you not get too deaf to God's voice because of the challenges that will come our way. You see, if you want to hear God well, we have to protect our capacity to hear him. Mm-hmm. I find it a fascinating and both challenging task and assignment to make sure I don't let anything into my ears. I got to be discriminatory, you know, about what I let into my ears. And, you know, I see folks, you know, walking around sometimes and they have earplugs. They'd be like, man, you're doing a whole lot. You do a little bit too much. I mean, you just walk around with yellow earplugs. They don't even go with your outfit. And, man, they just are so obvious that you are trying to block out a whole bunch of folk. Ain't that something? But wouldn't it be something if we cared that much about our own spiritual ears? That we put some obvious plugs. Be like, I can't deal with listening to what you're talking about today. Because you obviously trying to mess up my ability to hear God's voice. Jesus said it like this in John chapter 10, verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they know me. And what is so interesting about Jesus when he says this is that Jesus is speaking to some folk who are supposed to know who he is. And that you just walking with Jesus in proximity does not guarantee that you will be listening and hearing the voice of God well. How many know sometimes you can hear God's voice or listen to God's voice, but still not be clear about what God is saying, what God is calling you and I to do? And it is in this way that I hope today we can unpack some of why it is difficult for us to hear, listen, dare I say, respond to the voice of God. And yesterday here in the city of Berkeley, we saw all kind of folk trying to lift up their voice. They had some marches, and we saw folk outside and you know, talking about free speech. I think I even saw a sign being burned that said free speech on it. And they were upset because the Trump supporters were outside marching. And it just goes to remind me that, you know, although the freedom of speech is certainly protected by the documents, the founding documents of this country, and we ought to protect that and do as much as we can to be supportive of that. How many know all speech ain't free? Some of these words have the power to damage. Some of these phrases have the ability to sear the ear hair cells that cause us to hear God and, dare I say, even one another well. Amen. And that's why I think some folk get so turned up when you have racists and homophobes and xenophobes and all the phobes, all these folk who don't like anybody but themselves. And then they want to be out here and try to spew all that hatred. And then you just supposed to stand there and just take it. That's why I don't show up to them things, because I'm trying to be nonviolent. I want to be. Amen. So I just don't go. I just sit. I watch it online and be like, Lord, have mercy. Then people better thank God that I believe in Jesus. And hopefully Jesus believes in me. That's why I'm sitting right here at home. Because when the voice of God speaks, you should be able to recognize God's voice and distinguish it from the voices that are troubling the world. You know, how many of y'all got the Siri voices on your phone, right? You know, when I reset my phone, and I had to reset my Siri, so it makes me say my name a few times. Who is this? Well, it's actually a woman's voice. And I, Michael, say it again. Michael, say it again. And I don't know what's going on in that machine. But I think Siri is trying to recognize my voice. So when I speak out of everybody in my car, Siri will be able to recognize my voice versus yours. How is your Siri system working with God? Amen. I mean, when God says something, does the part in you that is your Siri recognize that voice versus the voice of everybody else? Or are you confused between God's voice, the devil's voice, your boo's voice, your homie's voice? Now, you know, people be like, you know, it's God or the devil. It's not God or the devil, amen. I mean, you know, there's a spectrum. The devil is, you know, he's about as far from God as you can get. But I hope your friend's voice ain't the same as the devil's voice. You better get you some new friends. I certainly hope your boo's voice ain't that voice either. You'd be like, I can't listen to your voice because, you know, you got me all messed up. No. But there should be a part of you that when God speaks, it should animate something inside you differently than anybody else's voice. When God says your name, you should be able inside of you to perk up in a different kind of way. When God gives you some direction, you ought to be able to know that this direction is a different set of directions than the directions from all my other voices in my life. And when the child of God can really hone in on that voice, you will more likely than not find yourself smack dab in the middle of God's purpose and will for your life, even when you find yourself in trouble. Oh, you ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell him, find that Siri voice. You got to find that Siri voice. Now, be clear. Be clear. That voice at the beginning of the process will often feel like your adversary, especially when you're not used to like following or being activated by that voice. I love St. Augustine. He has this quote, and he says that the word of God will be your adversary until it becomes the author of your salvation. Yes. Just leave that up there. Oh, you don't even have it up there? Are y'all paying attention back there? Y'all paying attention? The word of God will be your adversary. I wish I had a church, somebody that was paying. Touch your neighbor. Amen. Because some of us are visual learners, amen? The word of God will be your adversary until it becomes the author of your salvation. How many of you know sometimes I feel like God is speaking to me, but it kind of is pushing against some of what I think is true. But this is where you and I have to train ourselves to hear the voice of Jesus. Can you imagine when Jesus came on the scene? Jesus speaking to his disciples. Jesus telling them stuff and they ain't never heard it before. I mean, never heard it before. And Jesus had to retrain his disciples to hear his voice versus the voice of their tradition, the voice of their culture, the voice of the political leaders. I mean, Jesus had a job to do, and guess what? Not too many of them figured it out until Jesus was resurrected, because that became a convincing proof. It's like, okay, maybe what Jesus was talking about all along was actually worth believing. I mean, if the man can die and be walking around on 3 days later, I ain't seen that trick too many times, praise God. So part of what you and I must figure out is how can we hear this voice. So the book of Samuel, Samuel, this text that we're reading today is so important because you and I must be willing, the first thing the text says, is to be open to revelation. If we're going to hear God's voice, you have to be open to revelation. Somebody say revelation. Now Samuel, again, obviously in relationship with Eli. And up until this moment, the scripture says that Samuel had not yet learned who God was for himself. The Samuel's relationship was largely being mediated through Eli. And that's okay. It has its limitations, but all of us need an Eli in our life. All of us need some trusted folk. We talked about this last week a little bit. All of us need some folk who can help us, you know, kind of like when you're riding a bike and you got your training wheels on. That's what you need. You need some folk to help you not fall off the bike. But if you, like, I don't know, you see a 40-year-old person riding down the street with training wheels on, you kind of going to be like, it's like you got to learn how to kind of do that for yourself eventually now. I mean, these training wheels, you know, you only go so fast with some training wheels on, right? Do I have a witness in here today? Amen. You can only go so far if the relationship you have with God's voice is only being mediated even through someone who is a trusted spiritual advisor, mentor, pastor. Tell your neighbor, you got to know the Lord for yourself. You got to know the Lord for yourself. Now, not so important. Knowing the Lord for yourself don't mean that you become immutable. Meaning that, you know, well, whatever I heard from God, then I don't care what you got to say about it. I don't care what anybody else got to say because I heard a word. Amen. Because sometimes you can hear something that is not God's voice, and you can get mixed up. Anybody, be honest, ever got mixed up? Thought it was God? Ooh, you was confident that was your boo. Till you got that boo. Then your prayer changed. It wasn't, Lord, please, please, please let me have them. Now it was like, please, please, please get them away from me. Or you thought for sure that job or that career or that major, any students in the house. Woo, you was convinced and you prayed and you fasted because you heard a word from the Lord. So what you hearing should not be immutable, meaning it should not be, you got to be willing to allow it to have and withstand. She filled with joy today, ain't she? Stand some scrutiny, but you ought to be able to get a word from the Lord that when others, you go and talk to others, they weren't able to get that word on your behalf. But after they heard what you felt like God spoke to you, there's some resonance there. They can confirm the word. Hello, somebody. So you got to hear God's word. Be open to some revelation. Now, be mindful, like we said earlier, some of our hearing hairs and cells may have been seared. So you and I have to be open to new ideas about God. Be open to revelation. Jeremiah 33, verse 3 says, call to me and I will answer. I will tell you great and hidden things that you have not known. You ought to write that down, Jeremiah 33, verse 3. Remember, I'm telling y'all to get a new verse of scripture a day. You ought to put that on your little mirror while you're brushing your teeth or do whatever you do, and it just memorize. God, tell me some things that are hidden. Things that I won't know unless you speak to me in a way that I can hear it. And that's what happened to Samuel. Samuel was in his bed minding his own business, and God starts speaking to Samuel. Samuel didn't ask God to start speaking because God knows when you're ready to hear God's voice. And some of us are being talked to by God. And we're so closed-minded that we discount what God is trying to say to us. In the church, history, theology, we talk about revelation in two ways. We talk about general revelation. Somebody say general revelation. And then we talk about special revelation. Somebody say special revelation. General revelation is the way in which God reveals God's self through nature, through science, through math. There are some who think that God and science are in war with one another. No, God is not at war with science. God is not at war with reason. God is not at war with math. All of them are tools that help us see the magnanimity of God. Help us understand the ways of God. The problem is so many folk read the Bible as a flat book, and we think that, if it ain't in the King James, then it must not be true. But how many know God didn't speak King James English? I wish I could talk to somebody today. If the voice of God to you is King James English, you in trouble. Amen. Because God was not European, God sure enough was not close to King James. God speaks in whatever language he needs to get across to you what God's trying to say. In the 1600s, the best they had was King James. Hello, somebody. But there's some other translations or captured ways that God is speaking. And so general revelation is one of those ways. You can look at the nature and the stars, and it shows us there's some kind of intelligent design, if you will, that you can contemplate the evidence of God's presence in all of these ways, general revelation. But then there is special revelation. Somebody say special revelation. And special revelation refers to the unique self-disclosure of God through Christ Jesus and the church that Jesus gave birth to. Special revelation. There's some things you'll learn about God through Jesus that you won't learn by looking at the stars. Like, you can look at the stars and you can capture the beauty and the awesomeness of God, but you can't look at the stars and be shown how your heart is wicked. How mean and nasty you are to Hello, somebody. Ooh, it's quiet up in here today. Amen. Tell your neighbor, I need a special revelation. You can't look at the discovery of all these new planets. And that's not going to tell you nothing how mean you are to your partner or to your children or to your husband or your wife. How trifling you are on your job. How you harbor resentment and bitterness and unforgiveness. That's a special revelation. Hallelujah. And that's why when the Siri voice of God starts to speak on that special revelation, your heart ought to be open, because there's much at stake if you ignore the revelation of God to your life. There's much at stake when we as a country and a people ignore God's special revelation. The Bible says that sin is a reproach to every nation, but righteousness will exalt. Remember, righteousness means justice. Righteousness and justice, right? Action, right? Behavior, all of it exalts a nation. We in trouble as a nation if we can't hold on to the special revelation of God that tells us to ask God for forgiveness, to repent, to lament, to sacrifice, to love our enemies. You're not going to get that by just looking at nature now. So revelation, God is speaking to Samuel. Samuel had to be willing to be open to something different. And so my question to you today is, are you open to God's revealing what you've not known before? What has dulled your hearing to God's voice, this Siri voice, if you will? And how do you plan to regenerate and receive revelation? What is your plan to make sure that you are open to the revelation of God in your life, in our lives? If you don't have a plan, then you will not be open to revelation. Because being open to revelation means that you have to position yourself differently. You have to engage in some practices. Don't you know there are some places where you are more likely to get a revelation from God versus other places? I'd like to think that coming to church regularly at the Way in particular, touch your neighbor. But we ain't the only place, but it's one good place. That you may be more likely to get a revelation here than if you at Sweet Jimmy's down the street. You may get a general revelation from Sweet Jimmy's, praise God. I'm talking about a special one. I'm talking about that one where the Siri voice of God gets that. You're not going to get that at Sweet Jimmy's. I mean, I'm not going to say you definitely not, because God can speak anywhere. But if you in Sweet Jimmy's looking for a special revelation, I bet you God going to tell you, get out of Sweet Jimmy's. Hallelujah. Do I have a witness in here today? Anybody? I don't know. Some of y'all met y'all boo in Sweet Jimmy, so that may have been your special revelation. How many know after you meet your boo in Sweet Jimmy's, amen, you stop going to Sweet Jimmy's? There's a reason. So I say, mission accomplished, praise God. I got what I needed. How many know you more likely to hear a special revelation in prayer? In a prayer meeting. You ain't gonna hear no special revelation in a gossip session. Let's go to coffee and let's gossip. Let's see if God can speak to me through this gossip. I'm just trying to give you a couple pointers, because y'all asked, how do I hear the voice of God? You don't hear the voice of God through gossiping, through cussing and fighting and swearing, being mean and nasty. God, you drown out God's voice in that way. And I've had to learn it myself, because, you know, I grew up, y'all know, we grew up in a holy, a four-generation holiness Pentecostals. Amen. We got this thing in our blood, and it ain't going nowhere. Man. Hallelujah. My mission accomplished. Amen. But how many also know that there are still human weakness? You can be walking with Jesus your whole life, but you still got some human weakness that if you are not paying attention to that thing that's inside of you, that is not Siri's voice, the voice of God, that thing always speaking, and it's telling you, hit them, curse them, cut them off, fight them. Anybody got that voice on the inside of you? Yeah. The scripture calls it your flesh. Hello, somebody. You ought to give your neighbor a high five and tell him, I got some flesh in me, amen. I got some flesh in me. I'm not celebrating it. I'm just acknowledging that thing is there. And you and I have to learn to cultivate the voice of God so our flesh does not overpower God's voice. So some of these things that I appreciate about what are we going to do to make sure that we can be open to the revelation of God. The second thing that I think, if you're going to hear God's voice, Samuel teaches us, is that you have to be persistent. Somebody holler persistence. Now here you got Samuel in sleep, in the middle of the night, and he hears a voice, gets up, goes to the only voice of authority that he knows. Because it's obvious to him, this is not a voice of my friends, even of my mama. This is an authoritative voice. I'm going to get up and I'm going to go to the only authority I know, and that is Eli. But let's look at the conditions, the material conditions, as we would say in some of our, you know, analysis work. The material conditions by which Samuel is responding to this voice. Samuel was asleep in the middle of the night, and he kept hearing an authoritative voice, calling him out of his sleep, his place of comfort. My daughter's got this weird pattern, especially Nyla. Every few hours, and I'm sleeping in my house in my bed, and I hear people walking through the house. And I'm like, Lord, I just don't want to die tonight. I hope these folk ain't figured out a way to get up in my house past the alarm. Hope the CIA, COINTELPRO ain't in my house trying to mess with me tonight. Them the first thing to come to my mind. Then I walk out my bedroom, and it's Nyla walking through the house. What are you doing, girl? Can I come sleep in your bed? No. Go back to your bed and stop walking through this house. What's wrong with you? It's 1 a.m. Okay. Goes back to bed. Couple hours, sometimes minutes later. Now I'm not worried about COINTELPRO, the CIA, the men in black. I know I got a little old daughter who don't want to sleep at night and want to keep all of us awake. Try to negotiate with her. And man, my wife told me they was watching some scary movie, so now they are scared to go to sleep in their own room. I told them we ought to lock that door. Amen. It just because if we be trying to tell them, you watch all this scary stuff if you want to, I got to go to sleep. You keeping me up at night because of your bad decisions. That's why y'all better pray for them and these kids, amen. Because when Sharice goes away, boy, there's going to be some, we're going to get some get right, as they used to say. But I be so frustrated when I have to be awoken out of my sleep and then I can't go back to sleep. Samuel, consistently being awoken from his sleep to respond to the voice of God. Being moved out of his comfort zone. And Samuel was persistent because he realized that this voice was different than any other voice. How persistent are you and I that we will continue to respond to the voice we perceive to be God's? Because remember, Samuel didn't know it was God's, but he knew it was different. Something had sparked inside of Samuel that was different than any other voice, so he went to the closest voice he knew, and it was Eli's. Some of us are too quick to give up on learning and hearing the voice of God. God speaks and we don't understand it, and we like, okay, well, that was good effort. I'm back to regular scheduled programming. I mean, no, you got to be persistent. Keep going back. Wait, I'm trying to. Is this you, God? This is a different voice than anything I've heard before. What's at stake is so important that I need to keep responding to this voice. I need to keep asking God for clarity. Clarify what I'm hearing. Because if you don't get clarification, you will stay in deception. You will continue to be misguided. And there ain't nothing like a convinced fool. Anybody ever met somebody like that? Ooh, they so sure about what they know. But it's clear to everybody else, you are out to lunch. Why you keep doing this? You just convinced like the world is flat. Y'all been following this? Somehow, some of these brothers who I had such high regard for, I don't know if they're listening to Umar Johnson or these folk out here. They'll convince them that the world is flat. I hope none of y'all in here believe that. And if you do, I'm about to just walk down your row. You're going to be offended. Like, I can't believe Pastor talks so bad about me because I believe the world is flat. Maybe you've not flown in enough airplanes. Maybe you've not watched Gravity. I don't know what, seen enough pictures, but what would possess anyone to be convinced in 2017 that the world is flat? Convinced fool. Misguided. And how many know when you build your life off of foolishness and deception, the foolishness or deception will wreck your life even if your intention was not to have a wrecked life. That's why Jesus says, buy the truth and sell it not. Don't be a sellout. Give away the truth because somebody else got some theory that is unproven, untested, that contradicts the voice of God in your life. How many know the truth matters? That's what's so troubling right now about the climate in which we're living. We got folk out here just telling us fake news, alternative facts, and you just sitting around here like, am I living in the Twilight Zone? I mean, this can't be real. Did you meet with somebody? No, I didn't. Well, except when I did. And then folk got the nerve to be mad. They get upset when you call them out like, that's not true. What you mean that's not true? Fake news. You calling me a liar? No, you are a liar. And listen, the devil is a liar. Amen. Don't sell out for some foolishness. Be persistent in pursuing the truth. Be persistent in pursuing the voice of God, because God's voice will save your life. God's voice will save your family's life. God's voice will save your soul. Oh, there's a lot at stake to being persistent in hearing the voice of God. I love Samuel. Kept going back and going back and going back to a trusted source. Why? Because eventually the trusted source directed Samuel in the right direction. How many glad that God will always, if you are persistent, direct you in the right direction? I mean, Samuel was wrong in believing that God's voice was Eli's voice, but Eli was a trusted source. You need some Eli's in your life who will realize that what you are asking me to do, I can't do. Silver and gold I don't have, but what I do have, I give to you in the name of Jesus. You need some folk who are willing to hand you off to God. Can't do nothing else with you, because you're a piece of work, praise God. You keep waking me up in the middle of the night talking about God is speaking. God ain't, I got to go to sleep. So next time, what I want you to do is say, yes, Lord, your servant is listening. Question, what then is the question you need to have on this point? When I messed up my nose, got all beside myself and upset, are you ready? Or how many times does it take for you to stop pursuing God's voice? Can you keep going back to God until you understand? Is it one time? Is it two times? Is it three times? My prayer is, Lord, let me keep coming back until I get a full understanding. In all of your getting of knowledge, get a full understanding. That means that God will always give you a full understanding of what you need. God's not just going to let you just be floating around here in ignorance. Keep going back to God. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, keep going back to God. Keep going back to God. Keep going back to God. Keep going back and back and back and back. Because if you keep going back, God will give you what you need. The problem comes when you stop going back to God. You start leaning on your own understanding. Leaning on your own voice. Well, that sounds like, ain't no sounds like. Is it God or not? If it ain't God, you better just okay. Well, I'm a hold fast. That's why the scripture says what? Wait on the Lord. You ought to tell your soul right now. Wait. So say it. Wait, wait, wait. You get too big in a hurry, you'll miss out on the voice of God. Be persistent in going back to God. Last thing, then we're going to take a few moments to respond to this. You got to be ready to listen. We miss God's voice because we're not ready for God's voice. We're just not ready for it. We're just not ready to hear God's voice. But life will get you ready. There's a situation that's coming your way that will tune your voice real quick. Oh, God, that's what you were saying. All right, let me get out of this jail cell. Let me get off this sick bed. Let me get off out this terrible relationship. Let me get off this major. Let me change my practices. Because this is what you mean. But we're not ready. And the first act for some of us is to acknowledge we're not ready. When we used to do the 12-step program, the first thing that you had to do was what? Admit what? That you got a problem. Folk want to jump to 2, 3, 4 steps. And you're not ready to admit. Like Eddie Kane Jr. said, what? Just because I had one, maybe two drinks, would that make me an alcoholic? Yes. But you're not ready, Eddie Kane Jr. Dang. You're not ready. So guess what? You're going to continue to spiral. until you get ready. But Eddie Kane Jr. hit. Y'all know who's Eddie Kane Jr.? It's on Netflix. Go watch The Five Heartbeats. It will bless your life. Amen. It will. It's the greatest low-budget movie ever made. Please, it's my vote. You hit your rock bottom, and everything you heard will now be clear. God, I thank you that the rock bottom don't destroy the people of God. The rock bottom tunes my ear so I can hear God more clearly. Your marriage isn't hitting rock bottom. It's not to destroy it. Your personal health is hitting rock bottom. It's not to kill you. Our community hitting rock bottom is not to annihilate us. We are being tuned to hear God's voice. And guess what? There's some folk who not going to hear it before you hear it. But when you start to hear it, that's why the scripture says, cry aloud. Ooh, I feel like preaching today. And spare not. Lift up your voice like a trumpet in Zion. Show my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sin. That was an old school song we sing. But it was grounded in scripture. So they used to put old scriptures to songs. And we used to think it was a song, but it was actually a scripture. We in trouble now. Because these songs ain't grounded in no scripture. I don't know what they're grounded in. We walk around singing these songs, and that stuff is in you more than the word of God. And you wonder why when the devil come up against you, the only thing you got to give the devil is one of these lemonade songs. I'm not hating on lemonade, but the devil ain't gonna run from no lemonade. Well, unless your man is the devil, praise God. That may. Oh, thank you, Jesus. I don't know. All I'm saying is get you some scriptures too. Balance it out. You'll hear the voice of God much better if you got some scriptures. Right along with your Lil Wayne, Wheezy tunes, and yo, who else out here? Cause I can't. It don't help me at all. I can't do it. It's just too much. Stand with me, everybody. We getting ready to pray. Can you hear the voice of God? Can you hear the voice of God? Can you hear it? This is a question. Are you ready to hear the voice of God? Are you ready to hear God's voice in a way that transforms and changes your condition? Some of you may not be ready to hear God's voice yet, but I'm here to tell you God will meet you in your pleasure, your pain, your ups, your downs, your difficulties, your triumphs, your successes, your failures. God will meet you in the club. God will meet you on the street. God will meet you in the school. Because God's voice is not limited by your location or your circumstance. So you just got to ask the Lord, help me to be ready. That when you speak and tell me to go, I will go. When you tell me to go left, I'll go left. When you tell me to go right, I'll go right. When you tell me to go up, I'll go up. When you tell me to go down, tell me to stand still. Help my response to be, Lord, your servant is listening. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready. I'm ready.